Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Keep sober in spirit. Fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the former lusts which were yours in your ignorance, but like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves also in all your behavior, because it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. If you address as Father the one who impartially judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves in fear during the time of your stay on earth, knowing that you are not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life inherited from your forefathers, but with precious blood, as of a lamb unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for this opportunity that we have to worship you today. And we ask and pray that you, by your Spirit, would speak to us now through your word, that we may be transformed more into the image of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name I pray. Amen. Well, it just bears repeating again. I just want to say welcome home. So glad you're here today. If you weren't here last week for one reason or another, I want you to know we missed you. You're missed when you're gone. And last week, we started a new series out of the book of 1 Peter called Different. And I guess you could say it's a different kind of series. Different kind of series, different. I'll keep going, Ted. I'll just keep moving, all right? See, last week we learned that we're actually aliens in this world. And as such, we are called to be different because we are citizens of a different kingdom, the kingdom of God. We are sons and daughters of a different king, the one true king, Jesus Christ. And as such, we learned that we can actually possess and live out a different faith in the midst of the trials and difficulties of life, a faith that helps us live victoriously. But still, if you're like me, you're kind of left with lingering questions of how do we go about doing this? How do we go about living differently as aliens in the midst of our world? Well, we're going to be unpacking this a little bit in the sermon, just a little bit later. But for now, I want to give you a big idea. And I realize that I do this with a little bit of hesitation because when I give you the big idea, the temptation is to tune out. Hang with me. Don't go to sleep, all right? If your neighbor's kind of snoring, nudge him a little bit, all right? Jason, when Ashley starts dozing off, nudge her a little bit, okay? All right, okay. So here's your big idea for today. Here's your big idea, all right? Knowing Jesus is the path to living differently. If you don't get anything else out of this message, I hope that you'll take this with you. Knowing Jesus is the path to living differently. And I believe that most of us in the room would say amen to that. We'd say yes. But there's just one problem that we still experience. The biggest obstacle to knowing Jesus and loving him in such a way that it leads to us living out a different way of life is the fact that we desire to fit in. True? We desire to fit in. You see, it's so easy to go through life without recognizing that our perspectives of what constitutes a good and happy life have been shaped and formed by sources other than Jesus Christ and the gospel. True? You see, it's so easy for us all just to kind of long to be normal, you know, to fit in, to be like everybody else. Well, Pastor, come on. That's just for kids. Have we adults really grown past all of that? I want us to take a look at what passes off for normal these days. Normal is working ourselves into an early grave because we can't pay our bills on things that we bought that we didn't really need, but we bought them in order to keep up with people we don't even know and that we don't even like. Right? Normal is having a sexual relationship outside the covenant of marriage with multiple people resulting in multiple babies that have different daddies and mamas who are not in the picture. Normal these days is hiding behind a glowing screen, right? Instead of engaging in relationships with family and friends. Normal these days, if we're honest, is anger and slander and hatred and blowing up on people before they blow up on you. Right? True? So my friends, this is really, actually, this is just the beginning of what constitutes as normal these days. And here's the thing, and I think you'd agree with me, I don't think normal is working. Is it? I don't think normal's working. And I don't think it's working in our lives. I don't think it's working in our families, our society, our country. And Jesus, he actually warned us in the Gospels about this normal road in life and where it leads. In Matthew 7, 13 and 14, Jesus tells this. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction. And many enter through it, but small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. It is my prayer that Butler Church of the Nazarene would be among those who walk the different road, the road that leads to life. My prayer is also that because we possess this passionate love and desire for knowing Jesus, that more and more, we would help others discover belief in Jesus and experience a saving and sanctifying relationship with him. And in doing so, discover the path that leads to life. How many of you want to walk on the path that leads to life? Amen. You see, our Heavenly Father, my friends, is calling us to be different, to be aliens, to be set apart, to be holy. So where do we start? Well, to kind of get us moving in the right direction, I'd like us to think about a computer for a moment, okay? Now, computers are wonderful things as long as they work, right? When they don't work, they can be kind of frustrating. But, you know, one of the really cool things that you can do with a computer is you can wipe a hard drive. You can delete a lot of information very, very quickly. Now, that is fantastic when that's exactly what you want to do. But if you do that and you don't mean to do it, oh, man, you can actually lose 14 years worth of sermons and lessons and church material and videos and photos. Can you tell I'm the one that's had that happen to him? Not a fun thing. You see, I accidentally reformatted my hard drive, and I lost it all. You know, one of the things that I've discovered is that we as people, we are not so easily reformatted. Even after salvation, there are programs that need to be removed. There are memory patterns that need to be cleared. There is a default mode that is easily accessible. And when life becomes overwhelming, it's so easy to go back to those old patterns and processes and practices. And I believe this is why Peter tells us to prepare your minds for action. Prepare your minds for action. In other words, be alert. Don't just accept whatever comes through your way, whatever course of thought or philosophy that just kind of invades and flies through your life. In fact, the Apostle Paul, he spoke of an interior transformation that leads to an external change of life in Romans 12, 2. I know you folks know this passage. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So let's flesh this out, shall we? Via an example of how a particular mindset can impact the way we live, because sometimes we're impacted by different thought patterns and we don't even know it. For example, if you go searching for it, you can find teachers and articles and sermons and videos and lessons that will tell you that God's highest purpose and calling for our lives is our happiness. Now, please don't misunderstand what I'm trying to say. I am not trying to say God wants us all to be miserable. He doesn't want us to be misers who walk around with a scowl on our face, who never have fun or never enjoy the blessings that he gives us. Please, don't hear me say that. You see, there is nothing appealing about the person who says, "I'm holy and I'm miserable, and don't you want to come to Jesus and be like me?" There's really nothing appealing about that at all. So I'm not trying to say that, but go with me on this. Here's the problem. When happiness replaces holiness with God's highest calling and purpose for our lives, happiness is oftentimes based upon the happenings in our lives, right? And our happenings aren't always very happy. But there is a deep joy that can come from an abiding relationship with Jesus Christ in the midst of all of our happenings that forms and fashions us into something far more significant. It forms us into the character of Jesus. You see, God's highest purpose and calling for us as Jesus' followers is holiness. To be conformed to the character of Jesus. You see, he has called all of us to be set apart for him, to be different. And so, this is really where we have to prepare our minds for action. If we buy into a theology of happiness, it will be easy to act in our lives out of something that I call personal justification. And really what this means is you go about thinking, well, God wants me to be happy. That's the most important thing in life. God wants me to be happy, so that means I can do whatever I want, even if it's contrary to Scripture, as long as it makes me happy. For example, God wants me to be happy, and I'm not happy in my marriage, so that means I can look at all the pornography I want because it makes me happy. No. Well, God wants me to be happy, and I'm not happy in my lifestyle right now, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to steal, and I'm going to take every advantage I can in dealing with others or in business, or I'm going to go into massive amounts of debt and then not ever pay it back because, well, you know, I'm just not happy, so I've got to do what I want to be happy. I know this isn't easy. It's not easy to preach either. But I wouldn't be doing my job as your pastor if I didn't share this with you. Because if we buy into this theology of happiness, it empowers us to justify and rationalize just about anything out there. And from this perspective, we couldn't possibly dare think that things like delay or discomfort or inconvenience could possibly ever be part of God's plan for our lives. Couldn't possibly be things that God wants to use to help us grow and become more like him. And so this is why Peter says, prepare our minds for action. Prepare your minds for living life, in other words. Because otherwise, what can happen is we can begin worshiping the idols of pleasure or power or position or money or things or control. We can be doing that and not even know it. Listen again to Peter's words in verse 14. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the former lusts which were yours in your ignorance. Let me give you a little bit of context here. Peter's original audience, he was writing to primarily Gentile people. If you're not Jewish, that means it's us, okay? And so these folks didn't have a moral compass to save their lives. They didn't have anything to guide them. You see, in their education system, they taught a philosophy that separated the interior realms of the mind and the soul from the physical, which basically gave them the ability to do whatever they wanted in their bodies and be able to say, well, I'm good. What I do on the outside doesn't affect the inside. They were surrounded by religious systems, but they were centered in mythology of different gods who were bloodthirsty and promiscuous and power hungry. They lived without any concern over fornication, adultery, homosexuality, pedophilia. Emperor Nero led the way with all of those things inside his palace. And so Peter challenges this way of living. He calls to the believers, think about the bigger picture. He challenges them to live in loving and grateful obedience to the commands of God and to leave behind the lusts of their previous way of life. He tells them, y'all are different. You're not the same anymore. How? They had a personal revelation of Jesus Christ. They had experienced him. The grace of God had come to them. They've discovered belief in Jesus. They've received the message of the gospel. And because they've believed and they've received the good news, now they're different. They're no longer the same. They're aliens. Peter's thoughts, his words, they apply to us today too. You see, we once lived in ignorance, but we too have had a personal revelation and experience with Jesus Christ. We too have had the Holy Spirit come to us in grace, and we have believed the gospel, and we have received his message, received Christ. We too have been called to leave our past behind. You see, friends, as sons and daughters of the one true King, I beg of you, I pray that we will allow the Holy Spirit to wipe and reformat the hard drives of our minds. You see, we are sons and daughters of the one true King, and we are called to live into that identity and to let that identity be what we live out. We are dearly loved children of God. Oh, that is good news. And see, in Peter's words, we are called to be holy. Let's look at verses 15 and 16. But like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves also in all your behavior, because it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. Now the word holy here in the Greek is hagios, and it has a double meaning. And the first part is to be set apart for a sacred purpose. The second meaning of the word is to actually be morally pure. So in other words, we are called by God to be different. We're aliens who reflect the character of the Holy One that we worship and adore. Peter's call for all of us who call Jesus Christ our Savior King is to be holy because God is holy. And much like a child imitates their parents, we are called to imitate and follow the example of Christ. Well, Pastor, that has been a lot of really kind of heavy stuff, and that's great, but can you make it applicable? How do we do that? Thanks for asking. I'm glad you asked. I'd like to share a couple of ideas, okay? Let's get basic. Number one, be intentional about not slipping back. Be intentional about not slipping back. Peter says in the New Living Translation, I love the way this is translated, so you must live as God's obedient children. Don't slip back into your old ways of living to satisfy your own desires. How many of you know today that you can slip into trouble, but you can't slip into righteousness? Right? Right? Now, how many of you know that, or how many of you ever heard somebody say, well, I fell into sin? You know what? I've been doing this for 24 years as a senior pastor and an associate pastor. Not one time in 24 years have I ever heard somebody say, I fell into holiness. Not once. And we know why. Because it's not some sort of accident. We know better. And here's what we know. We have to be intentional about not slipping back into our old patterns of thinking and living. See, friends, we all have an enemy of our souls who wants you to slip up. He wants you to go back. His strategy, it's subtle and it's sinister. And here's how he gets us off the rails of a holy life. It's a strategy he's been using since the Garden of Eden. And it goes something like this. Did God really say? Did God really say? And I know this is where it gets kind of challenging, because sometimes, did God really say? Those areas of your life might be different than the areas of my life. But even more challenging is how tempting it is to deflect and minimize the presence of sin in our lives by saying things like, well, I'm better than so-and-so. Well, I'm better than them. My friends, I'd like to remind us, so-and-so and them are not the standard. Jesus Christ is. What they say and what they believe is not the standard. It's what Jesus has said. You see, we are sons and daughters of the one true King, and we are called to be formed and shaped into the image and likeness of Jesus Christ. Our calling is to be holy as God is holy. So number one, be intentional about not slipping back. And number two, be intentional about knowing Jesus. Number two, be intentional about knowing Jesus. 1 Peter chapter 1, 18 through 19 tells us, knowing that you were not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life inherited from your forefathers, but with precious blood, as of a lamb unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. Friends, because what Jesus has done, because he has redeemed us by his blood, you and I are made holy. Jesus Christ was the only one to live a perfect life that was unblemished with sin, spotless in regard to obedience to God. And in our own efforts and in our own strength, my friends, we have to realize we're not going to be obedient enough. We're not going to be good enough. We're not going to be holy enough. Gee, Pastor Jeremy, thanks for encouraging me today with that. That helps so much. Here's what we can do. You and I, we can sanctify, meaning set apart, we can sanctify Jesus Christ as the Lord of our lives. You see, we can freely offer him total control of our lives. We can devote ourselves entirely to him. We can pursue knowing him intimately and being known by him. We can pursue loving him first and being loved by him. For you see, my friends, knowing Jesus is the path to living differently. It's knowing him. And I guess the question that perhaps we need to reflect upon today is, do we desire to know him? And if not, perhaps we need to consider, do we have the desire to know him? And you know what? God can work with you right where you're at on that point too. That's what's so cool. And here's what I have found to be true in my life. Perhaps you have found it to be true in yours. The reality of life is we will become like what we love most in our lives. We will become like what we love most in our lives. And what we love the most will impact what we desire the most. And if Christ is who we love the most, our desires are going to be radically shaped around knowing him and pleasing him. And because of that desire and love, it's not going to be pulling teeth to live a holy life. It's just going to be just the normal overflow of a life that is lived in knowing Jesus. It's just going to be daily life, our desires being shaped and molded into his. And when we desire to know Jesus and to love Jesus most, it's not a matter of, oh man, I have to do this. Or, man, I don't get to do that. Or, oh, man, that fun thing, that wild thing that everybody else out there is doing, I don't get to do that. No, it's more like, I don't even desire that because I'm different. You see, I'm different on the inside. I'm going to pursue those things that will help my roots go down deep into the love of Jesus. And we're going to be abiding in him. And then he's going to be producing the fruit of the Spirit in and through us. And because we're becoming more like Jesus through supernatural means, you're just going to normally avoid those things that would take you back to your former way of life. You're going to be set free by a love that can only be described as different. I'm going to call my worship team up as I bring this message in for a landing, and I'm going to tell you a story. And I want you to picture this in your mind's eye if you can. I want you to picture in your imagination that you are living in an absolutely horrible living situation. This place is so small, but it was advertised as being big and spacious. It is so dirty and filthy and run down, but it was advertised as being new and clean. And the landlord seemed so inviting and so kind whenever they walked you through the demonstration home. But after you signed the contract, everything changed. The place that you ended up with is filthy. It's not new. Something else breaks or goes wrong every single day. And the landlord, he's never around. And whenever you reach out to him to have him come and fix the things that are broken or wrong, he just gets angry and he yells at you and hangs up on you and threatens you. But not only that, you've got this going on, and then you discover that your rent, it's just continually going up and up and up to the point that you can't afford to live there, and it's not worth what you would be paying anyway. And so when you go to the landlord to try and work something out, he threatens you and says, hey, you signed a contract, and there'll be consequences if you can't pay. And so, deflated and hopeless, you walk back to that old broken down home that you're living in. But along the way, you meet somebody new. They can see something's wrong. They can see the look on your face. And they ask you about it. And so you share your story. You share about what's going down. And you start breaking down into tears. And then something amazing happens. The person says, oh son, oh daughter, look in my eyes. Look in my eyes. And when you do, you see a look that can only be described as love. And they say, I'm a landlord too. In my homes, they're new and clean and spacious. And I love the people who stay in my homes. You're thinking, man, this sounds too good to be true. And so you say to them, well, sounds like a dream, but I'm indebted to my landlord and I've got no hope. And then the guy says, I'm going to go to your landlord and I'm going to pay the price to liberate you from all that mess. I want you to come and live in one of my homes free of charge. And you ask him, why in the world would you do such a thing for me? To which he says, because I love you. I love you. So you take the address really quickly. You're like, I got to get to this place before something changes, and you move into this new place, and you quickly discover this is like nothing you dreamed would ever be possible. Your new landlord is always around, always checking in on you, always helping you, and even more, he's continually impressing upon you that he wants to know you. He wants to be a part of your life. He wants you to know him. And so as you get to know him more and more and more, you discover that you've actually developed a love for this person that is bringing stability and peace to your life. After a little while, you get a knock on your door, and you open the door, and guess who's there? that old landlord. And that old landlord starts breathing his threats and saying, you owe me rent and you're no good and you deserve to be back in that old mess that you were living in before. And here, my friends, is where we have a decision to make. The intensity of our old landlord's threats, it assaults our minds, makes us scared. Will we believe him? Will we go back? Or will we live into our new identity and live into our new address that flows from a heavenly love? And will we tell that old landlord, I've got a new landlord, thank you very much, and I don't live in that place anymore. Ciao. Bye-bye. Friends, it really is true. Knowing Jesus is the path to living differently. It's the path to living a holy life. And I want you to know you have a new landlord. His name is Jesus. He loves you. And you don't have to live in that old place of sin anymore.